Funding for Firing Line is provided by this station and by other public television stations. Additional funding provided by Pepperdine University Associates.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Bill Bonosky, president of Pepperdine University, Malibu, California. This evening, the Pepperdine Associates, a distinguished group of 600 American leaders, are assembled in Los Angeles for a debate between John Kenneth Galbraith and William F. Buckley. This clash of ideas in the field of economics between two of the engaging personalities of our time symbolizes Pepperdine University's long tradition of devotion to public issues. An independent, voluntarily supported university, Pepperdine is committed to the economic and spiritual ideals upon which this nation was founded. Of all issues, none today is more crucial than the question of energy. And at the heart is the pricing problem. Should it be determined by the free market or by government mandate? Therefore, our topic for tonight's debate is resolved that the price of oil and natural gas should be regulated by the federal government. Affirming this proposition is the Harvard University economist John Kenneth Galbraith, distinguished former United States ambassador to India. Mr. Galbraith's widely read books, The Affluent Society, The New Industrial State, The Age of Uncertainty, promote strong centralized government with wage and price controls. On the other side is William F. Buckley, founder of National Review, the nation's premier conservative intellectual journal, first attracting national attention in 1951 with his book, God and Man at Yale. Mr. Buckley urges reliance upon the marketplace for economic decisions. Recipient of the Emmy Award for his television work, Mr. Buckley's syndicated column appears in more than 300 newspapers. Each speaker has 12 minutes for his opening statement, followed by rebuttals and cross-examination. Mr. Galbraith will speak first. Welcome, Mr. Galbraith.
Thank you very much, Mr. President. I'm sure that it won't take me a full 12 minutes to establish my position here this evening, because I'm very deeply content with the stand that I'm able to take before this distinguished gathering here in this hall and beyond, because for once in my life I don't have to bring the voice of liberalism over that of conservatism. If I had to do that, I might conceivably lose. But it's my good fortune, Mr. President, that this evening I bring the voice of reality over romance. And of reason over nostalgia. And I've only to look at this vast audience here in Los Angeles. I've only to look closely at this audience to see that I have reason, and also considering the general affluence of this gathering, reality on my side. I speak at a time when the production of oil and gas, the two energy items with which we're concerned mostly this evening, where in the case of both of these, the market has been extensively superseded by planning. And this planning, this supersession, has been planning, not by the federal government, not by other units of government, but essentially by the large and powerful enterprises which bring these products to us. Here in California, everyone is closely aware of the enormous enterprise which brought gasoline, or at least petroleum products, from the Alaska North Slope, and which presently, if plans proceed, will bring gas similarly from that field, in the one case down through the Pacific waters, and in the other case down across the wastelands of Canada to the consumers in this country. It would be insane, and I say this with special feeling for the oil men here in my audience, had you done this with reliance on the market. Nearly a decade of lead time was required in this enterprise. enormous investment running into the still uncalculated billions of dollars. And had there not been ultimate control of price by the firms responsible, this would have been an act of insanity. As it was, there is the concentration of power in the oil industry, which allows you, among other things, to control prices. And I may say that if anything were to go wrong with this process, with this control, were competition to break out, and were the investment in the Alaska pipeline to be threatened, nothing would so manifest itself as that marvelous flexibility of mind which would have every one of you back in Washington asking the federal government for some kind of price support, some kind of control of imports, something else, other way of dealing with the surplus involved. This petition to Washington would include, I'm sorry to say, indeed I'm delighted to say, even the most devoted readers of the National Review. It has happened before. And as the counterpart, perhaps more in the case of gas than in the case of oil, the counterpart of this power is the need for some assurance that it is not misused. This control operating either through public opinion or directly is the inevitable other side of the planning, which I think quite competently you do in getting these products over these great distances at such great cost. Or we may take, Mr. Chairman, another case, that of the oil imports, the OPEC imports. We have to take that market as it is given to us. And I don't think even Mr. Buckley, in his most charmingly romantic moments, will suggest that the market operates with the classical freedom as manifested in the OPEC price making. Prices from 20 to 100 times the cost of production. This very large price increase, combined with the extreme elasticity of the demand for these important products, has now produced a massive deficit in our balance of payments, an enormous pileup of dollars abroad, which then seek refuge in currencies which seem on occasion to be more secure than the dollar, and a very serious point, threaten the not terribly fragile but still not completely secure structure of international payments. Mr. Buckley and I have our neighbors part of the year in Switzerland. We both have a very personal interest in what has happened to the dollar in relation to the Swiss franc. Bill more seriously than I, because he lives at a higher level of living standards. But beyond the immediate concern of the fortunate people who can still afford to go abroad is a very great danger in this process. This is the result of the simple result of the fact that the market in relation to these products no longer works, as it no longer works in their consumption. There is another dynamic which controls the production of automobiles, another long-term process which also leads on to the management of that consumption to some extent. The people will want to buy the particular combination of novelty and banality that after several hundred millions General Motors gives us. And we find, therefore, an absence, a great disparity as between what the planning of the OPEC countries takes from us, the planning of the automobile companies requires in the form of fuel consumption as well as other uses of the same sort. And how do we bridge this? Again, we're bridging it by an extensive system of public regulation. If there are any strange, neglected Republicans in my audience, I would notice that the system of bridging the gap between imports of oil that are too large and consumption that is too large and what we deem we can afford was initiated by Mr. Nixon and Mr. Ford and Mr. William Simon, of all people, long before any tar of suspicion could be associated with any liberal Democrats. And this regulation is what happens when both consumption and production pass into the hands of large planning units, the large planning units which are essential if these large tasks are to be performed. We haven't yet come around to calling the very large planning organization that we have in Washington for dealing with this regulatory apparatus, a planning department. Back in the Republican days, the man who did that planning, initiated it, was called a czar. The impression being, of course, that that phrase is more democratic than planning. And I sometimes suspect, Bill, that no one ever told you Republicans what happens after czars. We should not be fooled. This is what happens as part of the broad thrust of economic development, the broad thrust of institutional patterns that give us these great organizations, the broad thrust of mass consumption, and there is no escape from it. I'm enchanted, as you will be, by the vision of that is occasionally presented, that we are going to be able to turn back the clock, releases ourselves from the very real headaches that this sort of thing involves, the lengthy processes of thought which are required by this development. But I warn you that tomorrow will come, and when tomorrow comes, you will have to put up with Galbraith rather than lead the much more charming vision that Buckley will now present for you.
Well, Professor Galbraith, your vision was presented within the time limit, for which we heartily congratulate you and appreciate the example you've set for your colleague, Mr. Buckley. 12 minutes for your opening statement.
Good evening, Dr. Banowski, Professor Galbraith, friends of Pepperdine. I have to confess that the temptation to regulate is not exclusively the impulse of the socialists of this world. I sometimes wonder whether the case couldn't, after all, be made for regulating the literary production of John Kenneth Galbraith. He says that I live at a higher level than he in Switzerland, which may be a free market's relative assessment of the value of our work. Now, Professor Galbraith grew up with earthy biases, both political and extra-political. It is recorded that when he was only 6 years old, his father took him along to a bucolic political rally in Ontario, in Canada, where he lived. The elder Galbraith began his speech by mounting a manure pile and promptly apologized for speaking from the Tory platform. And then a few years later, well into his teens, John Kenneth accompanied a lovely young girl of literal turn of mind out into the Canadian pastures, where he paused to observe a bull serving a young cow. "I think it would be fun to do that," said John Kenneth. His girlfriend replied matter-of-factly, "Well, go ahead, it's your cow." For years, we've been trying to remind Professor Galbraith that America is our cow. To no avail, he persists in serving us. It is, of course, his thesis now, as always, that the market has been superseded by natural events rather than by synthetic events. He refers to his kinship with reality and reason by contrast with my own, with romance and nostalgia. I do remember nostalgically when an agent of the federal government reported in 1885 that under no circumstances would any oil ever be discovered in California. Not to be outdone, another agency of government reported in 1891 that there was no oil at all in Kansas or Texas. Another agency of government reported in 1920, right after the First World War, that we had already consumed 75% of all of the petroleum resources of the United States. And of course, in 1939, Harold Ickes, you may remember, some of you, taught us that we had 13 years of oil left in our destiny. And in 1949, we were told that we had already seen the horizon of our resources. The fact of the matter is that we have a 40-year supply of tested reserves at this moment, but it is also correct that a feeling of finiteness impinges upon us, and as always, the interventionists reach for that contingency in order, to quote President Madison, to enhance power in the government. Now, says Professor Galbraith, it is historically our disposition to turn to the government when and if we get into any kind of economic trouble. It is certainly historically the disposition of all human beings to turn to anybody when they get into trouble. We are here today not to predict the behavior of American capitalists, but to advise it. It is certainly true, I assume, that the directors of Lockheed and Penn Central welcomed the subventions of the federal government. It also happens to be historically true that if it had not been for the Democratic vote in the Congress of the United States, they would not have received those subventions. It was the Republicans who voted in great masses against those subventions. In respect of the Alaskan pipeline, It is certainly true that in order to secure the credit for it, certain representations had to be made, and on those representations, much good faith rests. But what actually is the nature of the crisis? And to what extent are the people who actually produce the oil of the world responsible for it? The nature of that crisis is the cartelization of oil. By American businessmen? No. By Iranian businessmen? No. By a clutch of governments. 13 governments that oligopolistically took hold of a great reservoir of the supply of oil and quadrupled its prices overnight. This was not an economic act, though it had economic consequences. This was not the doing of the free marketplace, when suddenly the price of oil went from $4 to $12.50. This was an interruption of the free marketplace by political forces combined in restraint of trade and intending to extort to the highest extent possible from the people of the United States and from other oil-consuming nations all the money that they could. To react to this crisis by saying that we should impose a synthetic value on the price of American oil and gas is an attempt to maintain the level of water at disparate heights. It is, among other paradoxical things, a means by reducing demand of subsidizing the very oligopoly that has combined to extort from us. Mr. Galbraith is correct when he says that there is considerable Republican complicity in the matter of fixing prices. It was under a Republican president in 1954 that we fixed the price of gas, and under a Republican president in 1971 that we fixed the price of oil. The fact of the matter is that we made incorrect decisions. The fact of the matter is that the marketplace is constantly there to inform us of the nature of those incorrect decisions. For every 4% rise in the price of oil, there is a 1% reduction in its consumption. For every 5% increase in the price of oil, there is a 1% increase in its supply. When you consider that there is a 30% disparity between the price of oil at which it is regulated in the United States today and the price of world oil under the cartel prices, one can break down the figures and see that that disparity causes an 8% increase in consumption, which results in 3 million barrels per day extra being consumed, and a 6 million shortfall in supply, a six million gallon increase, a shortfall in supply, which results in just under $2 million in supply. The net result is that every day an extra 5 million barrels of oil are imported as a result of that disparity. There is a program. It is a program that seeks to comprehend both the political and the economic aspects of this. The United States should declare that it is our public policy to break the cartel, a cartel aimed at us and the other industrial powers as an act of economic warfare against us. Accordingly, we should categorize the nations, roughly speaking, with reference to the extractive cost of their fuel. Category A would be those nations that cost $1.50 approximately or less to pull the fuel out of the ground. Category C at the other end would be those, for instance, Great Britain in the North Sea, that spend $4.50 to $5.50. Category B would be in between. We should levy then a tax of $5 per barrel on category A, $3 on category B, and $1 on category C, punishing therefore those who seek primarily to extorters and to maximize their profit in surrealistic terms. Locally, we should have instant deregulation of oil and gas in order simultaneously to decrease our imports and increase our supply and reassert that majestic impartiality of the marketplace with which Mr. Galbraith, as a result of his failure to reason and failure to reckon with reality, is so manifestly unfamiliar.
From among the many questions received tonight from the audience, time will permit only two. The first to be addressed to Mr. Buckley is from Mrs. Will Durant, who, along with her husband Will Durant, is a founding member of the Pepperdine Associates and, of course, co-author of the highly celebrated story of civilization. Mrs. Will Durant.
Thank you. Mr. Buckley, in the history of the human race, reliance upon the accidental workings of the free market place of the free marketplace has done little to mitigate the suffering caused by gross human inequality. What does your position say to the poor, the hungry, the homeless, and the despairing?
Mrs. Durant, as an admirer of your 17 books, I hope you will go on to write an 18th in which you will record that the greatest benefactions ever performed for the poor and for the hungry have been in those societies that have encouraged the free economic enterprise of human beings.
Yeah.
Professor Galbraith, our rules allow a response on this question, if you have one.
Well, I think I have more sympathy for Mrs. Durant, perhaps less gracefully expressed than my good friend. No one knows better than the Durants how much indeed we do owe historically to the market. And no one has more eloquently said how great are the lacunae, how much of the indeed of the survival of the system is owing to our efforts to smooth over the rough edges and rescue the people who are indeed discarded and left out of attention by economic process. But I would also like to urge that there is here a process which is at work, and I'm very serious about this point, which is moving us away from the reliance which, quite rightly, 100 years ago, people placed on the market. Part of this is the power over prices, and indeed also over the consumer, that accrues to the very large enterprise, 1,000 of which now produce about half of our product. The discovery of trade unions, that they also can escape from the market, and wherever one has a large corporation, one has a strong trade union. And of farmers, who this very week are making their escape. And of people who have the minimum wage as a substitute for a union. And of the very large number of people who render public services, also who are organized now as they weren't 10 years ago. And I would like to urge everyone, however romantic his or her instincts, that this is a process which isn't going to be reversed, even by anyone so adept and eloquent as Bill Buckley, and that the practical aspect of life with which my good friends have dealt with so effectively requires us to come to terms with it. You will notice, Mr. Chairman, the skill with which I enlarged my original 12 minutes. Yes.
Our second question comes addressed to Dr. Galbraith from Mr. Richard C. Seaver, also a founding member of the Pepperdine Associates and president of the Hydro Company, whose gifts have made possible our Seaver College, the beautiful undergraduate ocean campus at Malibu. Mr. Seaver.
Dr. Malowski. Mr. Galbraith, considering the difficulty which our administration and national representatives have shown us in establishing an energy policy or a fiscal policy which supports the value of the dollar, or even a canal-giving policy, what reason do we have to hope that the same kind of apparatus can effectively set petroleum prices for the long-term national good, either in a reasonable or realistic way, or a romantic or nostalgic one?
That question, I suspect, has built in it its own answer, at least the one that would be preferred. I'm far too old a hand ever to get into the position of defending the perfectibility either of public or of private enterprise. And there have been mistakes in the past, and I'm sure, Mr. Seaver, there will be many more in the future. I would very much like to have a world in which it was not necessary to make the effort. I'm afraid that there's no escape, and for the reasons that I mentioned, that as long as the broad thrust of industrial development gives us no process for an equitable adjustment of supply to demand by the market, then we have no alternative to the kind of government intervention which, fumbling as it is, primitive as it yet is, we're beginning to see in the development of what we call an energy policy. And that it would be irresponsible for us now to stop and say we're going to have no more of this. We're going to try to stop and turn back the clock and risk the return to some market utopia which is gone forever. I'm sorry not to be more optimistic to a man of such obvious charm and generosity. Let me assure you that we will agree on all other matters except this.
Well, the answer to Mr. Seaver's question, how can we be sure that the government will make a satisfactory price level? The answer is, we can only be sure that it will be unsatisfactory. This is not an attempt at frivolity. This is a discrete application of a philosophy that springs from a knowledge of human nature. The moment anyone seeks to advise two parties on a continuing basis of the nature of what it is that will be simultaneously satisfactory to both, that person suffers from a hubris. It is that hubris, that sense of pride, that caused Adam Smith to say, not only can we not set prices, because it is impossible to ingest the myriad considerations that go into the setting of a satisfactory price, we must reject as public servants anybody who thinks that he can set prices. It is that second lesson, which is a political corollary of the first, which is an economic law.
Now I think for the real heart of the debate tonight, the cross-examination section is designed to give each debater maximum freedom to interrogate directly his opponent in an open exchange. We have allotted 14 minutes for this section, And Mr. Galbraith has the first half of that.
Well, I shall make my questions appropriately brief. My first is whether, Bill, you would be willing to join with me to bring Adam Smith back to the next meeting of the Pepperdine Associates under appropriate circumstances, Mr. President, to explain and affirm what I think would be met, a point that would be met both by you and some of the audience with some discontent, namely his feeling that a world in which corporations, or joint stock companies as he called them, existed would be inconsistent with his system and that they should be prohibited, and to allow him to express his concern over one in which the development of these great private planning organizations, which he would have excluded, would not feel that these had destroyed his system.
The questions that Adam Smith raised about private stock companies had to do with the regulation via that mechanism.
Or their monopoly.
Failure of regulation. Now, it seems to me that if Adam Smith were here today, he would be satisfied by the rise and fall of great industries that sought to frustrate the consumer, the consumer exercises and continues to exercise that leverage that justifies the laissez-faire with which Adam Smith is identified. I would remind you that most of the mammoth corporations you pointed to in one of your books as dominating us as though we were mere puppets, or either at this point bankrupt or living off the government.
Could I pursue that point and ask which?
Well, I exaggerated a little bit. But the thesis of one of Mr. Galbraith's books was that the huge companies in America have become so important, so vital, and so domineering that, in fact, they can regulate their own worth by causing people, for instance, to consume their products, by causing legislature to pass congenial laws, and so on and so forth. Unhappily, his book was published just when the market slid the value of most of these corporations by about 85%. But this is a datum that Mr. Galbraith, with characteristic savoir-faire, has simply transcended.
I certainly don't want to suggest that Mr. Buckley ever exaggerates. What year was it that the market declined by 85%?
No, the companies, some of the companies that you mentioned, as a matter of fact, I think Lytton Industries is one of them, wasn't it?
What?
I think Lytton Industries is one of them. One of those radio companies was one of them, too. I had a long list. In fact, I recited it to you.
Oh, but you said the stock market in general.
What's that?
Oh, I certainly allow for...
Well, the stock market in general went down 40 to 50%
allow for exceptions, but I dined earlier this evening with Mr. Tex Thornton, and I didn't ask him, but I could see from the charmed look on his face that Lytton Industries has recovered from that temporary misfortune.
Coincidental with your book going out of print.
One of the marvelous good fortunes of being an author that I share with William Buckley, and there are some points that some things we do have in common, is that authors, unlike automobile companies, are not yet required to recall their defective works. The difference between us is that I have this inner sense of security coming from a long record of valid interpretation, which allows me to make confessions of that sort, and Bill does not. Am I supposed to pursue this, these questions further, Mr. Chairman?
Two more minutes.
Oh, I have lots more. Bill, where did you get those figures on the elasticity of demand? Is that another exaggeration?
I got them from a study published by your colleagues in Harvard.
It's not an absolute assurance of accuracy.
Are you referring to your former students?
There you go. And one final question. You suggested that the automobile companies, out of the goodness of their heart and their instinct for market response, were advertising the gasoline-saving character of their vehicles. Are you aware also that they are advertising, are impelled in that direction because they have been so mandated by the Department of Energy?
No.
Yeah, they have been.
No,
I will,
because you
I will
see,
help you,
you
out
you
on
you
that.
You don't advertise what you're required to do.
Oh, sometimes.
They don't. If you set out as an advertising salesman to lure somebody to buy your car rather than the competitor car on the grounds that yours consumes less gas, it isn't, you're not doing this in order to advertise your compliance with the federal regulation.
I'm required to make the, to ask questions, so I put this in a question. Would you yourself consider what you had previously attributed to the market and which I now attribute to legislation and your handling of that an especially talented evasion?
No, but I would classify your defenselessness as obvious.
Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Galbraith. Mr. Buckley, you have 7 minutes for a cross-examination of Dr. Galbraith.
Well, first of all, let me apologize to Mr. Galbraith for not being more specific. I really don't know whether these two scholars went to Harvard, but their names are Robert Hall and Robert Pindick, and their study was published in the Public Interest in the fall of 1977. I would like to ask Mr. Galbraith this. Are there circumstances, and if so, what are they, under which a state is justified in using force of whatever kind to protect itself from cartels?
I think not, Bill. I'm extremely reluctant ever to suggest that force, with its accelerating consequences, I take it you mean military force.
No, not necessarily. Any kind of force.
You mean the police power?
Or taxation?
Oh, yes, certainly. But I thought you were referring to the possibility of a military crusade against the OPEC countries, and this is an idea which I abhor.
Well, we're not talking,
but
we're not talking
so
much about...
I take back my suggestion. If you were not asking it, mm-hmm. I exempt you from the
Let's begin by postulating that from time to time, we both presumably have to do things we abhor.
Oh, absolutely.
So we're not talking about whether you abhor, but whether you visualize circumstances under which certain things need to be done. For instance, suppose Japan, which is entirely dependent on the importation of fuel, were boycotted by the Persian Gulf nations and OPEC as a result of some political offense of a kind, for instance, that Holland committed when it was boycotted towards the end of 1973. What would you think the justifiable limits of Japan's reaction under such circumstances?
Well, I can never bring myself, for a variety of reasons, particularly because one doesn't know the end product, ever to suggest a forcible military response in the abstract. That Japan should react by counter-economic action I would think entirely possible in those circumstances and entirely justifiable.
You would. And therefore, something less than that, for instance, a differential tariff of the kind I proposed, would be perfectly understandable to you.
I think I wasn't reacting to your tariffs, Bill, or your taxation. I was just expressing my pure joy over the fact that after having launched a major attack on government regulation, you ended up advocating what in many ways and for many purposes and for many people is the most ruthless form of taxation, a ruthless form of regulation, namely the punitive force of the taxing power.
In other words, you were struck by the paradox.
Beg your pardon?
You were struck by the paradox. I believe in laissez-faire, but I also believe in capital punishment. Yep. Does that paradox strike you as even more engrossing?
I think if I may say so, one must make a distinction between paradox and flat-out self-contradiction.
Well, in that case, make it.
I did.
All right. So, in other words, Mr. Galbraith does understand the necessity of war under certain circumstances, but doesn't understand the necessity of tariffs under lesser circumstances. Let me ask you this. What is the justification,
Mr. Galbraith? I separate myself from the justification for war.
What is the justification for the current price of gas at $1.47, which is the BTU equivalent of $4.20 per barrel of oil? I mean, what muses in Harvard are consulted to arrive at ratios of that sort?
Oh, this is a question I cannot answer, Bill. I don't know.
Well, can't you give us a lead?
No, certainly. Certainly not, because, exceptional as it may be this evening, I act only out of information.
Since the disparity is at least prima facie difficult to penetrate, you would then concede that Mr. Siva has made a pretty good point in saying that this is the kind of thing that happens when you turn pricing over to the government.
That the possibility of error here is something which unites Buckley, Siva, and Galbraith. There's no question about it. I carefully avoided any defense of the government which was based on perfectibility. Only my defense was entirely on the basis of necessity and practical good judgment.
Well, on the whole, isn't it better to suffer exclusively from one's own errors than to inflict them on other people?
I would have no doubt that that was that was true. But unfortunately, I do not think it has any relation to this topic under discussion.
Thank you very much, Mr. Galbraith.
Now, as the discussion draws to a close, each debater is given 3 minutes for a closing summation. Since Mr. Galbraith is affirming the proposition, he is given the final word tonight in the academic custom, so that Mr. Buckley has 3 minutes for summation.
Essentially, Mr. Galbraith has characteristically challenged the therapeutic value of the marketplace to make necessary adjustments. The fact of the matter is that we are, at this moment, subsidizing to the estimated extent of 5 million barrels of oil, foreign nations who have conspired together to extort a maximum price from the industrial nations of the world. This we do by, on the one hand, encouraging a synthetic demand and causing a flow of dollars that makes impossible that economic reconciliation which would bring natural forces to bear toward the situation. Now, we are, in a sense, dealing with an ethical question. We are, in a sense, dealing with an economic question. Ultimately, I think that we are dealing with a philosophical question. That one being whether we are going to turn, again to quote President Adams, every contingency as an excuse for enhancing power in the government. Mr. William Simon has estimated that under the contemplated energy program of our Democratic president, there will be $70 billion of redistribution involved by the contemplated bureaucracy. Instead, there seems to be this fright at the prospect of a, quote, windfall profit. The fear of that windfall profit is dominating a public policy at the expense of consumers. Insofar as we are able to penetrate the question, we see once again the necessity of combined action, permissive as regards economics, encouraging people to use their enterprise and deploy their capital. As regards the political, and we must advise the nations of the world that it is unsafe to conspire against us at any level, and that to the extent that they feel that they can, at meetings in remote capitals of the world, dictate the standard of living in this country and of other countries, we, for so long as we have resources to resist, will resist. But this is no argument whatever for deserting that marketplace that has shown us out of so many economic dilemmas in the past. Thank you.
I would be very sorry if anyone thought that I was disposed to abandon the very useful instrument of the market where it works. My case is only that we've been engaged in a massive retreat from that institution. That is the nature of industrial development, particularly so in the oil industry, that we must, as practical men and women, accommodate to that great historical thrust. As to the question of the windfall gains, I think I halfway agree with Bill Buckley that it has been unfortunate that the discussion of an energy bill for the last year has turned on so largely on that issue. On the other hand, it will appear to many of you, I'm sure, as a question as to whether the producers of oil, of old oil in the United States, should be automatically accorded the level of prices which he describes as so extortionate when set by the OPEC countries. And that's the case that has been debated. But I agree with him that the debate has gone on much too long. Bill Buckley made a very important point, and I think if one is proceeding from a position of certainty and security in an argument of this sort, Mr. President, one can afford to make occasional concessions. He did a valuable thing when he emphasized that that gasoline consumption, gasoline and diesel fuel consumption, is not the overwhelming part of the total. I thought, Bill, your figure was a little smaller. I would have thought it was somewhere in the order of 30-odd percent in the United States. That's unimportant. It is very important to keep in mind, as he suggests, that feedstocks for industrial use and also for home heating are a very large part of this total. And this brings me then to my final point, which is again a method, a difference really in method. Bill Buckley would attack the problem of oil imports. He doesn't deny the need for doing so by massive increases in tariffs and in prices. They would, given the inelasticity of demand for these products, have to be massive. It's one way of doing it. I'm very much attracted by less violent methods, making somewhat less use of the taxing power. I've been attracted for some time by the suggestion that was put forward most recently by Mr. Miller, the new head of the Federal Reserve, that we first set a limit on petroleum imports and then accommodate internal policy to those imports, which I would then seek to do by having a price differentials as between basic gasoline consumption, basic home fuel consumption, and a very large price on the marginal consumption over and above the basic unit. I think that's the way to go about it. This, it seems to me, will have the strongest possible conservation effect, and in combination with existing prices, which I don't think are lacking in incentive effect, we have, I believe, the right way of proceeding. The most unfortunate sign was held up about 12 and a half seconds ago, saying my time had already then been exhausted. Mr. Chairman, I'm very sorry, but in an audience of this sort, I'm sure there's an unlimited tolerance of truth.
Ladies and gentlemen, this concludes our debate. The Pepperdine University Associates have been very pleased to bring you this important public discussion. I think it's appropriate at this time that we express our warm appreciation to both of these worthy participants.
Printed bound transcript of this program, send $1 to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina 29250. Indicate the subject of the program and please allow 3 weeks for delivery. This program was produced by SECA, which is solely responsible for its content. Funding was provided by this station and by other public television stations. Additional funding provided by Pepperdine University Associates.